Praise God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. To God alone be the glory. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program where we edify, we exhort, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us, and we just want to wish you a happy new year in advance. For some of you in Australasia, maybe you're getting close, and some parts of Asia. So we just want to thank God for bringing us to the end of 2017, and we believe and trust that He's gonna lead us safely into 2018. Today, we are going to wrap up our Christmas series with the topic, Becoming Wise and Wealthy. Becoming Wise and Wealthy. And our case study is going to be the wise man. But before we start, you know by now, you know, right? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Oh, dear Jesus. You are so beautiful than description, too marvelous for words. Father, you are too wonderful for comprehension. Thank you for your faithfulness all through 2017. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for this program. Thank you for the lives that have been touched. And Father, we ask that even today, it shall be a greater blessing to every one of us as you lead us out of 2017, that you will prepare us with this message for 2018. Thank you, Father God, for in Jesus' name have we prayed. Amen and amen. Again, the topic is becoming wise and wealthy, and the case study is going to be the wise man. And your short reading, our short reading, I've read it. So you're going to read the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, verse 1, you stop at 12. Matthew, chapter 2, verse 1 to 12. Now, for this lesson, the foundation text is going to be Gospel according to John, chapter 14, verse 14. John 14, 14. If you ask anything in my name, this is Jesus speaking now. In other words, in accordance to my character, I will do it. If you ask anything in my name, consistent with my character, this is Jesus speaking, I will do it. Now, a lot of Christians, believers, they rip that page off or that verse, and they are bringing their shopping list to Jesus and quoting that John 14, 14. When he said, in my name, he's saying, inconsistent with my character. Okay, so next time, before you bring your shopping list out to God, ask yourself, how is this going to glorify Jesus? How is this going to expand the cause of the cross? If the answer is no, you know the answer already, so don't bother to pray about it. Look for something else that will glorify Jesus and expand the gospel. Amen. All right. Following the example of the wise men, how can we become wise and wealthy? Those are good words, right? And those are good things if they happen to anyone, to be wise and to be wealthy. Who wouldn't like that? So let's see how they did it, these magi, the wise men. Number one, they came asking. The wise men knew that the star they saw was not ordinary. Just like as you are listening to me right now, and the Holy Spirit is already working on your conscience, on your heart, and you are saying, maybe I need to listen to this lady. That is God telling you, this is not just ordinary talk. This is the word of God, especially sent to you. So the wise men, they knew the star they saw was different from the common ones. So they decided to explore it. So I'm asking you, what are you going to do with this sermon by the time we finish? You ought to be thinking about it. So this brought them to Jerusalem. History tells us that they traveled about 300 miles because they came from the east, which would have been anywhere from Mesopotamia or Babylon. So that would have been 300 miles away from Jerusalem. The Bible doesn't tell us how they came, but history theorized that maybe they came on Arabian horses, on camels, or donkeys. We don't know, but one thing is sure, they did not come in planes. No, there were no aeroplanes, and they did not come by car, you see. It was a treacherous journey that had its own difficulties of distance, discomfort, and dangers on the road. There were thieves, robbers on the road at the time, you see. But they refused to be daunted by these personal discouragements. The wise men made it into Christmas story for all times, you see. Because they used wisdom to obtain a memorializing wealth for themselves. Now, listen up. Watch this. Jim Elliot. I don't know if you've ever heard of him, a wonderful missionary, 29 years of age, in 1965. He was killed on January the 8th, 1965. Really? I'm sorry, 1956. Yeah, I got it. 1956, at the age of 29. He only had one little baby with his wife. They'd only been married for 3 years, Elizabeth. His wife went to be with the Lord last year, December, I believe. And he was a missionary to the Alcos Indian tribe in Ecuador. And cut a long story short, on January the 8th, 1956, the locals, the Indian tribes there, they threw spears at him and four other missionaries, Nate Saints and three other brothers, and they killed all of them. But when he was going there, and because the Indian tribes at the time, they were very vicious and they were not kind to outsiders and all that, they killed people. And they were telling him, as a young man, you know, he said this when he was asked, "You going to that area?" And he said, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." Let me say that again. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. End of quote. That's Jim Elliot. Now, your personal discouragement may be potential loss of friendships, jobs, inheritance, anything. Those may be the things that are staring you in the face, that if you decide for Jesus, you stand to lose these things. Listen up. You're going to lose them anyway. Because if you don't walk away from friends or relatives, if you stick together, guess what? One day death is going to separate you. One will die and one will be left here, you see. There's going to be loss anyway. So if that is what is scaring you of making a decision for Jesus, listen up. That's not good enough. Okay? The wise men did not allow their personal discouragement to dissuade them from coming to Jerusalem. Don't let those personal things that appear like you are going to lose stop you from making a decision for Jesus. No. However, no one ever loses by coming to ask Jesus for salvation of their soul. It has never happened. No. But even if you are going to lose friendships or a job or something, it's nothing compared to anything. It's nothing compared to eternity with Christ in never-ending joy and peace if you come to Jesus. Let's go to the book of Psalm, chapter 102, verse 17. The book of Psalms, we are going to read from chapter 102, verse 17. It says, "He shall regard the prayer of the destitute, the poor, or the humble, and shall not despise their prayer." Listen up. I'm yet to see somebody that to say, "I pray to Jesus, how I can be saved or to come and save me, and he didn't listen to my prayer." That's not the Jesus of the Bible that saved me. Oh no. Okay, because he has promised that he will not despise your prayer. A genuine asking about salvation brings a speedy answering from the Savior. Let's say that again. It gives me a lot of hope, huh? A genuine asking about salvation brings a speedy answering from the Savior. Moving on. The tamed stray. Not only they came asking, the tamed stray. The wise men came in contact with a deceptive and wicked king called Herod. I wish we had the time. It's a very dense topic that we just don't have the time, really. This is a huge topic. But the Lord is helping anyway. So they came in contact with Herod in search of the miracle baby Jesus. Now, Herod, listen up, represented the political class, the world. He represented the world system. However, in their search for Jesus, when they came to this Herod of a king who tried to condemn, Herod called for the scribes and the chief priests, who were the religious class of the time. Now, the religious class did not show any interest in search of this newborn baby that was called the King of the Jews, even though they were Jews themselves, you see. Now, the wise men would have been discouraged by the lack of interest of the religious Jewish class. When they traveled 300 miles to come and visit this King of the Jews that was born, and they came to Jerusalem, and the religious class could not be bothered. Listen up now. Am I the only one? It would be discouraging for me personally. I don't know about you, but not this wise man. Now watch this. Many people do not have problem about walking away from the world system to follow Jesus. See, some people, they are worried about whether we lose their friends or they have to have a change of job. Maybe their job is not a good one for following Jesus and all that. Many people, they don't have problems with that, you see. But they have problems deciding for Jesus, watch this, because of the hypocrisy of the religious people that they know, you see. That will not be a tenable excuse on the day of judgment if you are one of those people. It's not going to be. All right? So don't say, "Oh God, I'm going to tell God on that day, there's a priest next to my house. He's a child molester. He lives a double life. That's the reason." It's not going to work. All right? So listen up. If children of alcoholics can decide not to live like their parents and they succeed in doing so. The decision to follow Jesus concerning your eternal destination is equally a personal one. Are you understanding this? So if somebody that you know in your neighborhood or your workplace is a fraud, a fake Christian, they don't practice what they preach, don't let that stop you from coming to Jesus. Don't follow them to hell. Oh no. There are so many pastors with their castle, they are going to hell. Oh yeah. Because they are not practicing what they are teaching, you see. So don't join them. Don't let them stop you from coming to Jesus. The wise men did not allow the religious group of Jerusalem to discourage them from looking for Jesus. Let's go to Ezekiel 18:20. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 18, verse 20, it says, "The soul that sins, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him." You see, the Bible is very clear. So don't let anybody discourage you. You come to Jesus. If a pastor wants to continue messing around your neighborhood and they are still preaching, listen, God wants them to change, but if they don't change, he's going to get his judgment anyway. But don't let him or her stop you from your own salvation. God will not accept external derision as a pardon for a personal decision. Let's say that again. Because all those fake Christians that are trying to discourage you, they are making a mockery of Christianity. But God will not accept external derision as a pardon for a personal decision. It's not going to happen. Moving on. They came bringing. The wise men came with meaningful and useful gifts. They gave gold, which was a present fit for the king. And we're talking real gold, not fake one, okay? They gave frankincense, which was the spice used in burning incense in the temple to worship God. And then they gave myrrh, which was a spice used in embalming dead bodies. And these were expensive stuff, okay? Now, the myrrh was to signify Christ's sacrificial death. Maybe somewhere in the future, if the Lord tarries, that's a lesson on its own. Okay? But at this point, I'm going to pause and address believers. If you're already a child of God, what do you give to God? Huh? What kind of gift do you give to God? Your tips? Jesus will not accept tips. Oh no, he's not a beggar. He owns the whole world. When they ask you to give food, donate food to the food bank, do you donate expired food? Huh? Things you cannot eat. And you say you are donating to God. No, you are not. When they ask you to donate clothes to send to some poor kids or missionaries that need some clothing, do you give them the one that is torn or the colors have all run out and you can't wear them anymore? Is that what you call a gift for God? Listen, if you are a Christian and you give gifts that you cannot use yourself, that is not meaningful, that is not useful for the person you are going to give it to, guess what? It's meaningless to God too. So don't give gifts that will bring a curse into your life. Don't do that in 2018. Do not. If you have been doing it, ask God to forgive you and change your way. Alright? Now, if you are an unbeliever, Jesus is not asking for your money. Keep your money. Let me say that slowly. If you are a pagan, an unbeliever, you still don't believe in Jesus, keep your money. Hold tight to your wallet. Keep your food, and keep your clothes. Jesus doesn't need any of that from you. Now, this is what Jesus needs from you. Whoever wants to come to Jesus without their most valuable gift cannot be enriched by Christ Jesus, who owns everything. You do not lose anything that are beneficial to you when you give everything you are and that you have to Christ. For example, if you have a good sense of humor before you gave your life to Jesus, you don't lose it. Your skills, your intellect, you don't lose that just because you gave your life to Jesus. So anything that is beneficial to your life, you don't lose. The only things you lose when you give your life to Jesus are the things that are detrimental to your life. For example, I lost my anger when I became a child of God. My arrogance, I lost it when I became a child of God, you see. Because they were detrimental to my being, you see. When you give your heart to Christ, watch this. Your heart is worth more than the wise man's gifts. And that is why, if you are yet to be a child of God, if you are yet to give your life to Jesus, that is why the only gift Jesus is asking from you is your heart. Got it? Your heart. That's all he's asking. Whoever gives their heart to the Lord will not have struggle to release all other things to the Lord and to the cause of the gospel. So if you are a non-believer, keep your money, but give your heart to Jesus. All right? Let's go to the gospel according to Dr. Luke, St. Luke chapter 10, verse 27. So he answered and said, this was a lawyer that was trying to test Jesus, how he could inherit eternal life. He thought it's something you buy from Jesus. And Jesus said, what did the law say? What do you understand by it? So the lawyer is now responding. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. You see, he quoted from the book of Deuteronomy. You see, and he quoted right. Because Jesus himself said, upon these hangs the law and the prophets, you see. So if you love the Lord your God, you will give him your heart as a non-believer. If you love the Lord your God with all your heart as a believer, you will love your neighbor, and when they are needy, you will not give them what you cannot use. Amen. To pile it up is to be miserable. To pass it on is to be memorable. Don't you love that? Let's say that again. To pile it up is to be miserable. To pass it on is to be memorable. Pass it on. Amen. Okay, another thing that the wise men did, they changed journey. The wise men were obedient to the warning they received from the angel of the Lord. They did not go back to Herod. You see, they didn't know that Herod was a horrible human being. So the angel of God told them, and they obeyed. Wisdom is to run from whatever God hates. That is wisdom, folks. That's it. There is no wisdom pills. No. But when you see something that you know God is not gonna like and you go the other way, that is wisdom. When you do that, you attract God's attention for blessing. God's blessings come in diverse ways, like, for example, healing for the sick. A sick man is not gonna be asking God for money. He doesn't need it. No. He wants his body to be well, you see. A businessman will be asking God for good business. Somebody who is restless in their spirit, they just want peace of mind, you see. So God's blessings come in diverse ways. Many of God's children do not know, please listen up, when God's blessings come upon them, because their own idea of God's blessings is according to their own definition. When you say God's blessing, the only thing some people can think of is dollars. Really, money. So cheap, really. The wisdom in obedience spared the lives of the wise men, and the spiritual wealth they gained from their Bethlehem tree was their story that forever made it into the Bible. There is no greater wealth than that. For over 2,000 years, people are still talking about you. They are still reading about you from generation to generation, from Asia to Africa, Europe to Americas, to Oceania, I mean into the Middle East. Everywhere, every culture, they talk about you just because of a trip that you made. That's you. All the money in the World Bank cannot buy that, right? So that was the way they became wealthy. You see, their own wealth was not money. No, their wealth is that their names and what they did, their story became memorialized so much so that all over the world, literally, we talk about them, we read about them at least once every year, you see. And God wants you to leave that kind of a legacy for generations to come, to be talking about you in your bloodline, in your community, you see. So that's much more than money. It's impossible to live according to the word of God and not receive the wealth which is in Christ Jesus. It's impossible. It has never happened. I wish I could start giving you testimonies, personal testimonies, and the testimonies of people that I know who, from their obedience to the word of God, God has blessed them, as they say in the South, in Texas here, that God will bless your socks off. I mean, it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. So you cannot obey the word of God and not be blessed. It's impossible. Job 36 verse 11. The book of Job, chapter 36 verse 11. It says, if they obey and serve him, serve who? Serve Jesus. They shall spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. Righteous living breeds various blessings. Joseph and Zion, this is a beautiful bread on the go. Let's say that again. Righteous living breeds various blessings. You want to be blessed? You need to start living according to this book. Amen. So, using our case study, the wise men, how do we become wise and wealthy? Number one, they came asking. This is to decide one's eternal choice, knowing it is personal. The tamed strain. This is to refuse to be discouraged by anything around us from pursuing God's plan of salvation for our lives. They came bringing. This is to come to Jesus with our priceless gift, your heart. They changed journey. This is living in obedience to the word of God. So let's conclude for this last Bible teaching for this year. Are you a believer, but some areas of your life are suffering from drought? And of course, I'm not talking literal drought. I'm talking metaphorical drought. Prayerfully, take an inventory of your spiritual life, of things you have done in 2017. Let the Holy Spirit show you where you got things wrong. Whatever the Lord convicts you of, take correction. Okay? Let the Bible and prayer be the cornerstones of your resolution in 2018. Don't just wish it. No. Do it prayerfully with the Bible and prayer. I pray that in 2018, you will be a partaker of God's wisdom and the wealth that we receive through Christ Jesus. Now, if you're an unbeliever, it is impossible to have access to the wisdom and wealth of Christ Jesus. It's impossible. You see, because you are God's creation, but you are not yet His child. Big difference. Because you are His creation, when it rains in your neighborhood, it doesn't exclude your house because you have not yet given your life to Him. No, that's general blessing. The oxygen that you have in your nostrils, general blessing, you see. But there are some special blessings of God's wisdom and wealth reserved exclusively for His children. That's what I'm talking about. But you can access it. That's the good news, you see. You can. How? By giving your heart to Jesus. You've traveled up to 2017 just roaming aimlessly in life. Seriously, you said, Josephine Zion, I have a job. I have a good job. I have a big house. It's still useless without Jesus. But that can change, all right? I'm going to say a quick prayer right now. And a link is coming. Follow that link. There we will meet you with instructions on how to give your life to Jesus. And get a Bible. Start from the Gospel according to John. From chapter 1, and be reading at least 15 minutes every day. Same time. Don't miss it. Every day in 2018. And write to me if you have Bible questions or you are seeing changes in your life. Write me a letter. I'm good with writing. I will respond to you. Okay? Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Your word has gone out. Father, I pray you will convict your children where they need to fix things for their lives to move forward in 2018. And the unbelievers that want to give their hearts to you, Jesus, let them hear your voice, your loving voice, to let them know how much you love them. Thank you, Father God. Father, when it shall be 2018, let it be, Lord, that we will have so many testimonies to share. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I will see you in 2018, in Jesus' name, if the Lord Jesus has not split the sky open.